The West Penra Papers. A Journey Through the Multiverse. The Third Level of Learning. http://westpenry.com. The Third Level of Learning. Paper Number 2, In Wait for Things to Come. By West Penra, Friday, February 1, 2013. Part 1. 1. The First Alien Invasion and Its Main Distraction, Nibiru. In the previous paper I stated that the alien invasion has already happened at least to some extent but that it is still not completed. It looks like they have planned the takeover in at least two phases, where phase I is already accomplished. The first phase was happening very much behind the scenes and was discussed in details in level 2. What it is, or at least what they want us to believe, is that phase 2 is going to be the harvest. The big secret was that we were not supposed to know there was a phase 1. For a while I thought nothing of real substance, besides from my own and others' evolvement, was going to happen in 2012, until I suddenly realized how it all had been done, and how we all had been distracted by looking in other directions so we would miss the point. Nibiru was only one of those distractions, although the story of the A.A.M.I in general is correct. However, Nibiru is not the home planet of the Sirians, A.A.M.I, but a hollowed-out space-slash-battleship. Albeit, the point is that it's not here in the Earth vicinity to create havoc. That idea was abandoned decades ago, something that both James of the Wingmakers, Mahunahi, Barbara Marciniak's Pleiadians, and Amitak Stanford indicate as well. I am not a fan of Amitaka's research otherwise, but here she is right on the spot. Mahunahi said already back in 2008, in the now classic interview with Project Camelot, that Nibiru is not going to be a threat, and the Pleiadians have stated the same thing for years. These are metaphysical beings, and they are telling us there is no Nibiru anywhere near the solar system. And I trust them with that, because they have showed to be a very reliable source over the last 25 years. This is what Amitak Stanford has to say about this whole scenario. Of the many surviving calendars, a considerable focus for divining has been on the Aztec/Mayan calendar, which many have interpreted as an indicator of the end of time in the year 2012. As 2012 approaches, more and more interest is drawn to its ominous consequences. Books, movies, articles are being distributed that focus on the idea of predictions that are attached to the year 2012. Many people have interpreted this to be the date for the end of time, hence, the end of the world. As I have previously written, the Mayan/Aztec calendar was an imposition on the planet that originated from the Anunnaki elite, who had escaped from their future into the past, which is where they left the Anunnaki remnants. That is, the Anunnaki remnants were left on the Earth to fend for themselves and await the return of the Anunnaki elite, whom the remnants believed would return to Earth and restart time. Note, the Mayan calendar originated from the Pleiadians and their teachers, the so-called Game Masters. But Stanford is correct, because we know them as the Anunnaki elite, or in my papers, the Sirian Alliance, S.A. Wes. Long ago, the Anunnaki elite were responsible for the creation of the Aztec/Mayan calendar, which gave the false postulation that 2012 could well be the end of this planet. Millennia ago, at the time the calendar was manufactured, the Anunnaki elite thought that they could come back to Earth and revisit the past to reset the ATUIA before 2012, but they have failed, and time has run out for them because the ATUIA had to be restarted before the end of 2008. Note, Mahunahi of the Wingmakers said something similar in his 2008 interview with Project Camelot. He mentioned that Anu's return had been planned for a long time, and so had the return of Nibiru. However, plans have changed, and Anu is not coming back and neither is Nibiru, which indicates that Mahu knows it is a battleship they can maneuver as they wish. He says the return of Anu was scheduled for 2008, so he had a few years to prepare before 2012, but it will not happen, and it didn't. However, Sirians came back in thought form and invaded certain bodies they had prepared. Mahu also indicates that Anu and his people are time traveler and as such, Anu always is ahead of the game and can prepare things to happen before anyone else has a chance to make their move. Wes. The prediction of 2012 as the end of the world is not only wrong, it is a cruel and deliberate hoax. The world will not end in 2012, despite all the fear-mongering propaganda that is being distributed at the behest of the ruling elite on Earth. Many of the people are innocently participating in the distribution of the message because they have been hoodwinked by the ruling elite. The 2012 calendar threat is similar to the Y2K panic and the nuclear Holocaust horror that the ruling elite have instigated and implemented. All three of the events are hoaxes that were designed by the Anunnaki and impressed on people to spread about the planet. Obviously, the 2012 hoax is a longer-standing deception than the nuclear horror threat and the Y2K panic. The 2012 hoax is also akin to the Save the Planet message because of greenhouse gases. Asterisk from the Save the Planet message, laws were implemented to asterisk prohibit incandescent light bulbs. Asterisk mandate carbon trading schemes. Asterisk force ethanol blend petrol on motorists. Among other things. The ideals behind the green movement were initially well intended, but the ruling elite have seized control of the Save the Planet issue, and it has now become another powerful tool of the One World Government. The consistent theme throughout the 2012 hoax, the Y2K scare and the greenhouse gas deceptive policies is that all of these weapons were designed by Anunnaki to be used against humans. I'm going to jump around a little bit here in the beginning, because so much has happened even in the short amount of time since I completed level 2. I want to show you the following picture and advise the reader to read the space.com article connected to it, and also check out the slideshow. Now they are promoting in mainstream media how we humans are going to use asteroids to exploit their resources, just like the Syrians once did. Like if that wasn't synchronicity enough, they also say in the article, which can be viewed here, http://www.space.com/15387-asteroid-mining-planetary-resources-gallery.html, that soon we can colonize space with these asteroids. They are hollowing them out, my friends. The Syrians are becoming quite blatant, but are also doing what they love to do, hide the truth in plain sight. Their human minions sound really excited when I listen to them being interviewed about this on CNN News and other places, saying that these hollowed-out asteroids can be used for a lot of things, such as extracting water from them so NASA can use this water in space whenever they need it for a fraction of the cost of transporting water from Earth to space, and therefore it becomes a business proposal, CNN, January 23, 13. They can also excavate gold, minerals, and other valuable metals from these flying rocks, but are planning on making them into satellites and space stations as well. The CNN anchor then distinguished between good asteroids and bad asteroids, where the bad ones are those who come too close to Earth and create havoc here. After that, she shot off the punchline, the question she'd been told to ask before the interview, "You could tell, if we can manage these good asteroids, can we use them to steer away the bad ones so we are not hit by them?" And the scientist they were interviewing knew exactly how to sell this to the public by saying something to the effect, "Of course, that's possible. We can use our technology to push the bad asteroids just an inch or two out of course already when they are far away so they get out of course by the time they would have hit Earth otherwise." I saw this information days ago and posted articles from space.com and io9 on my blog, http://battleofearth.wordpress.com/2013/01/23/asteroid-mining-project-aims-deep-space-colonization and http://battleofearth.wordpress.com/2013/01/08/nasa-considers-plan-to-capture-and-asteroid-turn-it-into-turn-it-hyphen-space-hyphen-station, respectively, but yesterday, on January 23, 2013, it made headlines everywhere in the world, being the top news on CNN and in all prominent newspapers. So this is big, my friends. In other words, they want to sell the public on this idea with space stations, satellites, hollowed-out asteroids, and the ability to make us feel safe, when the real reason I can see is entirely different. The Syrians are now building hollowed-out battleships in the thousands here in our solar system, right before our oblivious eyes, in order to create a space armada for an upcoming war, and they are using humans to build those for them. And why not? The human super soldiers we are creating, and the rest of the humans, too, who can fight, better get used to it, because they are the ones we're going to use in the upcoming space war, they seem to think. I also ran this through one of my sources, who said it looks inevitable that there is going to be another galactic war if this continues. And as the reader will see when you continue reading these papers, the Syrians here in our solar system are going to get help, and that help is on its way as we speak, moving quickly towards our solar system. My source thinks that the Syrians are preparing a war with Orion, and if that happens, Orion has no choice but to respond. And in the middle, as usual, are the human population, used as shields and cannon fodder. So it will always be, from now until our extinction, unless we understand whom we're dealing with, and have the guts to say no, and just walk away from all this insanity. The reason why I write my papers, by the way, if someone was wondering. What I have been trying to say lately is that Nibiru was just a distraction so we could keep our minds and efforts away from researching what is, and was, really happening in alien invasion on a nano level. This doesn't mean that Nibiru doesn't exist, it only means it's not the home planet of the Syrians, thrown out of an orbit around one of the Sirius stars when it went nova, and incidentally happened to find its way to our solar system. The disinfo agents know what they're doing, however, and they know the real story. You see, the Syrians did come here to Earth once upon a time, and one of their battleships, perhaps the lead one, was called Nibiru after the Queen of the Stars' personal spaceship, the name was hijacked. So that part of the story is true. However, what has been covered up is that the Syrians still live in Sirius and Nibiru is just one of thousands upon thousands of hollowed-out asteroids, planetoids, moons, or planets that the Syrian Alliance use for space travel and as efficient battleships. So the story about Nibiru is semi-true, but not a threat to Earth in the way we've been taught. And these days they don't even call the battleship Nibiru anymore, but A.AM.E, apparently. Another name, but the same vessel. For decades, well, ever since Zecharia Sitchin came out with his first book, The 12th Planet, in 1976, have we been living with the fear mongering around an incoming, perhaps inhabited planet which may or may not become our nemesis. It was in the mainstream newspapers in the 1980s, but since the 1990s, tons of books and an abundance of websites have been dedicated to this mystery planet which supposedly housed the even more mysterious space aliens, the Anunnaki. I fell for this piece of distraction and disinformation as well, planned for decades, if not even more, by the PTB Def and their masters, the Syrians. Now, when I understand which role this piece of disinfo and distraction had, it all becomes quite obvious. But doesn't fact remain that some kind of object has been spotted within, or close to the solar system, the last few years? Something that is coming closer? Possibly. The question is, what is it? Well, according to the fear-mongers who keep pushing this story, Nibiru is now somewhere extremely close to Earth within 1 AU or so. First of all, if this was the case, wouldn't we feel the Earth changes pretty drastically now? Especially as this alleged planet is many, many times bigger than Earth and is followed by at least 9, perhaps 11 moons. Albeit, we hear of course that there are those who are sitting meditating this heavenly body off course to save mankind. However, in my opinion, even they are deceived, only doing what they think is the best they can do to help out with a huge, non-existing, problem. Behind the scenes, there are others pulling the strings, who know better, but want to gain credibility and create a bond between the manipulators and those who are manipulated. Some people are chosen to do this thing because they have special abilities, as the story goes. Where have we heard that before? You got it. Cult recruiters have used the phrase "you are special" on people for eons to get them recruited. It usually works. What I'm talking about here, however, isn't necessarily a cult, but those behind the scenes know human psychology pretty well. Like I mentioned earlier, We have asteroids coming close to Earth all the time, and the latest story about that has been in the news lately. Although some say that NASA is lying and that the asteroids are much bigger than they will admit to the public, I think it's safe to say that we will survive February 15, 2013, when the next asteroid named DA14 is supposed to come close to Earth. However, as you notice, more fear-mongering is created around this event. Many fall for this latest one, too. Others say that the doomsday has been changed to March 2013. There will be people who continue changing the dates now when it didn't happen in 2012, but it will all be disinformation and more fear-mongering. They are trying to squeeze out as much fear they can from the public before they change subjects. Some people say that Nibiru, as we know it, actually is Earth's second sun, which has been invisible to us here on Earth because of its position in space. This has been called the brown dwarf theory. I have not researched it enough to know if there is any substance to it, but I'd rather put my money on that than I would on the Assyrian home planet theory, which I don't trust at all. A double star system? Why not? I read from a channeled session with the Cassiopeians that our solar system indeed is a double star system, and that the whole solar system is orbiting a brown dwarf star, which is located in the Oort cloud on an outer perimeter orbital plane at a distance of approximately 510 billion miles, well outside the orbit of Pluto. This brown dwarf has a mass much less than our known yellow sun, if we are to believe the Cassiopeians. The distance, of course, between planets and this brown dwarf would in that case fluctuate, but allegedly this brown dwarf is the reason why there has been abnormalities noticed in the orbits of the outer moons lately. This session is dated September 15, 2010. The closest this second sun will come to any of the planets in the solar system is about the orbit of Pluto, and this is what is supposedly going to happen now. No catastrophe, folks, just some abnormalities in the planetary orbits, perhaps also in regards to Earth. This brown dwarf, however, may very well have been confused with Nibiru. It's not easy for someone who has not spent a lot of time researching to understand what is going on here. But the following is probably the most plausible scenario as I see it right now. The Syrians are showing humans how to hollow out asteroids and give the public a false pretense that this is to exploit resources and colonize space. Instead, they are building a future space armada right here, in our own solar system that they can use in conjunction with the human military in the not too far away future. People in general think the public version sounds cool, oblivious of what is really going on. Next step is something we will go into later in this paper, and also the next. It has to do with the harvest and saviors in general. Many had put their faith on 2012 and that some kind of savior was going to come and save the world and themselves. It didn't happen. To make things even more discouraging for people with such faith, and they are many, is that the PTB made sure we had some predates back in 2011 etc., where something of this nature was going to happen. Of course, it didn't. People get more and more discouraged and are ready to accept almost anybody as their savior, as long as they have a plan for mankind that looks good. The wars and negativities continue around the world, and the only ones, more or less, who are saved from that are those who have started vibrating on a higher frequency so all that negativity does not reach them personally. Otherwise, business as usual. People are getting tired of this and are in need of a change. This is where the Syrians come in. Helpful star races are impatiently waiting for us to take the right decision and take responsibility for our own situation and start ignoring the PTB and build our own communities where new, much improved rules are applied which are all for the betterment of the group and the individuals in them. Although this is about to happen to a certain extent, the vast majority of star races have no such intentions. The Syrians have already invaded many people's minds, especially those in power, and have now directly taken over much of business and trade, religion and education, instead of just controlling the situations like puppet masters from other dimensions. The vessels were already built, so to speak, and are continuing to be built, so the Syrians can incarnate here or do a walk-in death in human bodies that are slightly altered genetically, but on the outside identical to yours and mine. Then, when the harvest is taking place, and some people are supposedly getting beamed up to a higher density, leaving others behind, the planet may be losing many of their New Age leaders, whom they have looked up to and given their power to, instead of building their own. I will talk a lot about upcoming events in regards to the alleged harvest soon, but if that plan will succeed, and from whatever angle we look at it, it's not positive, then the Syrians think they have us, because they believe those who were in the New Age community and who had to stay behind now think life is so unfair that they may be ready to give up. Not to speak about the fear they feel when they realize that they did not graduate to the next level slash density, and now have to be dumped on another 3D planet in another solar system the next time they incarnate, and time will start all over again, a new 26,000 years of slavery in a harsh 3D environment. That's when it's time for our heroes, the Syrians, to come into the picture, now showing up in the open. Speaking of disclosure, they will tell us they have the ability to save mankind and it's now time to join the Galactic Federation of Light or something of the sort. They have the technology to help mankind take the last step in order to become galactic citizens in a spacefaring race. When NASA and most governments in the world, who are already under Syrian control and influence, will agree and suggest to people that we all join, so everybody will have a good life in the Machine Kingdom, they will of course not use those words. Those who don't want to join are on their own, but can't take advantage of any benefits the rest of mankind can enjoy in the mega metropolitans that are planned to be built, so-called smart cities. Everything is smart these days, have you noticed? So, if this succeeds, the Syrians will kill three birds with one stone, they win us over with deception and technology and thus manage to unite the world, except the small percentage who refuse to participate and are forced out of the cities. They make peace with the PTB in front of the peoples of Earth, saying that forgiveness is what we all need now and join together as one into a time of peace and harmony. And lastly, the Syrians can rule openly in this well-planned Machine Kingdom. Little does humanity know what consequences that will have for them in the future. It will start out like a paradise on Earth, but will end up in a living hell, and it will come creeping upon them so they won't even notice. The future will judge me on what I'm saying here, and I am not concerned, because what I'm telling you is correct and will hold up to scrutiny 100 years from now. That is what they are planning for those who fall into the trap of the new era, the Age of Aquarius. I will expose this trap to the best of my ability in this level of learning, and I think that those who finish reading it will have little doubt afterwards that this is how it is. And of course, here is where the splitting of the worlds which I have talked about so much come into the picture. Choose the easy path and let the Syrians take care of you, or choose the path of responsibility, which perhaps will require a little bit more from you at first, but in the end will show to be the easiest path after all. The problem here as well is the ETS who are out there, waiting to be of assistance, but don't hear any calls for help, except from a few individuals here and there. This is why there will be no disclosure, my friends. No good ETS will disclose themselves to an oppressive government. The so-called disclosure will therefore not happen the way irresponsible people such as Dr. Stephen Greer and Dr. Richard Boylan present it, and who are willing to embrace any ET races who are showing themselves to us, without using discernment. Instead, good ETS will present themselves to individuals who are ready to receive the messages from the stars and who are responsible enough to have such a connection established. If ETS are disclosing themselves in public and it's all over the news, count on that this is either a well-planned hoax by the government, or if the ETS are real, they are not here for our benefit. I've said this before, but it's worth repeating. And don't forget that the Syrian Alliance are trying to create a master race, a super race of humans, who are half human and half robotic, whom they can use for future conquering of space and their ongoing war against Orion, or more specifically, the Mother Goddess, the All That Island. I want to take the opportunity here as well to emphasize one important thing. I don't want people to live with the false idea that just because star beings and star races out there are much ahead of us when comes both to technology, star travel, and development in general, that they are all like saints, or benevolent towards humans. There are star races out there who could be considered very advanced and billions of years old, who still are fighting wars and have quite a selfish, service to self, or STS DEF for short, attitude to existence, just as well as there are star races which are very humble, friendly, and spiritually inclined. As above, so below. And lastly, we know that the Syrians don't come down here in their native bodies, because this is 3D and they are interdimensional. Some say they are 4D negative, and if you're an interdimensional being, you would never feel comfortable living in a locked-in 3D world. This is one of the reasons they don't just show up and invade, there are many other reasons too, which the reader probably can think of. They want human bodies, but not any human bodies. They need bodies that vibrate a little bit higher than the average human. Therefore, they are also tampering with Earth's frequency via HAARP and other technologies. This has nothing to do with that Mother Earth herself is changing her vibrations, this is done with technology. The truth is quite the opposite, the Syrians do not want Earth to naturally change her vibrations, because then the ET control of this world will diminish. Instead, they only want to increase the frequency so they can feel more comfortable, but suppress further evolution. Not all humans can handle the higher frequency and get sick, often with neurological problems. Unfortunately, the Syrians have no sense or respect for life, and they couldn't care less about how Mother Earth feels when she's being tampered with. It's a miracle that she still is willing to host life on this planet, but if we don't take heed, there will come a time when she is giving up. And finally, 10, 20, 50, 100 years from now, those who are waiting for Nibiru to show up in the sky will still be waiting in vain. 2. What we don't know is bound to kill us. I am aware of that much of what I am exposing here can be quite disturbing and may scare some people. This is not my intention, however, although I know it's inevitable. Things are what they are, and I can't sugarcoat it and hope for the best, I need to tell it as it is, or what I'm doing would be useless. People who say, no, I don't want to listen to that. I only want to listen to love and light. Better shape up and stop being cowards. We all need to look at both the dark and the light side of ourselves and our environment, or we'll be stuck in a horrible imbalance. If people can't even handle how words are written without freaking out, how are they going to be able to face the real thing when it's just in front of their faces? Still, these bad things I'm about to describe in this and upcoming papers is not necessarily going to happen to you, personally. In the other levels of learning, I have clearly stated that it's extremely important that we create our own local universe just the way we want it, and look at the bad news as something that happens over there, but with a clear understanding of what's going on. It's not going to be part of your reality. This is crucial, because none of us wants to be caught up in this space scenario for real. Some people may think it's exciting, and a break from their own boring life and tell themselves that it would maybe be fun to live in the middle of a space opera. No, it wouldn't. And once we make such a suggestion for ourselves, we create that timeline and will quite likely find ourselves in the middle of something we have a hard time getting out of. So be careful what you wish. This is just some good advice before we move on. We need to know what is going on, because what we don't know is bound to kill us. We have a tendency to think we are the top of the food chain, but we are not. Thousands upon thousands of people disappear from the surface of the Earth every year without a trace, and no one knows what happened to them. Of course, there can be different reasons for their disappearance, but many of them are eaten by the Syrians and their allies. When they are in 3D, they need flesh, and they have gotten a taste for humans. Just like we breed cattle to slaughter and eat, so do they with us. And they drink our blood like water and even bathe in it to make it fill their pores. It gives them an adrenaline rush, and as we know by now, our blood is divine, and they use it to contact the higher realms, the universe of the goddess. I am telling the reader this to make sure you understand that in general, these people are what they are. They do not consider themselves evil, as little as we consider ourselves evil when we slaughter lambs, cows, chickens, etc. We consider them being of lower consciousness, so we think it's okay to kill without mercy. They have the same attitude towards us. And they are brought up with the mentality that it's either conquer or die, there is no stagnation. Expand your empire, or someone will take it away from you. What does that tell us? Well, it's telling us that they are very fearful themselves, and in order to conquer their own fear, each individual strives for power, thinking that the higher up in the hierarchy they climb, the less they are bound to be used and slaughtered themselves. The respect they have created by getting their will, they think, help them survive if they at the same time induce fear in those who are beneath them in the hierarchy. They want to create a rumor about themselves that they are merciless, so no one dares to challenge them. This is to be a coward to the extreme. Right now, here on Earth, we are on the bottom of that totem pole, and they feed on our fear. This is the daily life for a wolf and reptilian Syrian. Want to join their empire? Now, to be fair, not all Syrians are like this. Just like people on our planet don't like when they see how animal are cruelly slaughtered while screaming in pain, and have a distaste for injustice and war, there are Syrians who feel the same about what they are doing. But again, just like with us, there are few who dare to stand up against authority, and in their society the consequences would be much more severe than here on Earth, in general. Perhaps more like how it would be to go against the president in an earthly dictatorship, you would be tortured and killed. So, understandably, there must be very few Syrians who dare to take side with humans, unless they flee from their own society and join ours. This has happened, and is happening, I'm sure. The best way to do that is to incarnate here with full memory of who you are, i.e. you need a specially built human body for that, as we shall see in an upcoming paper. The consequences from the first invasion has started to show now. It needs to be understood that this invasion did not happen overnight, it has been ongoing for decades, even centuries. Human bodies have been altered in order for Syrian consciousness to enter, so that the job can get done. What job, you may think? The job to prepare Earth for the second invasion, or phase two as I call it. It's like when a team of janitors, carpenters, architects, and others come before the royal crew to clean up and prepare for what the second, important group needs to get accomplished, so they can do it without too much distractions. I see a lot happening right now, and it has been highlighted in the news the last few days. One thing the Syrian overlords fear is the middle class. They are often educated, sometimes quite highly educated, capable, and smarter than the overlords think is comfortable. Therefore, they have wished to get rid of the middle class for decades. I even wrote about it on my first website, Illuminati News, 14 years ago in an article called The Swedish Model. Their goal is to have an elite and a low-paid working class and nothing in between. This way, they think the masses will be easier to control, but it also makes the system collapse, which is something they want in order to prepare a one-world government for the second invader force. This plan, however, is way behind schedule, and may even have been temporarily abandoned. Their biggest task right now is to create the machine kingdom. That, hopefully, from their point of view, will automatically lead to a one-world government later on. Yesterday's news carried a lot of information for those who could read between the lines. They were talking about how many jobs had disappeared since the recession, and that they are not coming back. In earlier recessions, like back in the 1990s, the system took a few years to recover, but eventually the jobs returned and things went back to normal. It will not happen this time, the newspapers said. Instead, the middle-class jobs are being taken over by computers, robots, and other high-tech. This means that the middle-class workers will have no jobs to come back to, and people with too much education will rarely get jobs at McDonald's and other places with minimal wage, because they are considered overcompetent for the job. And we have not seen the end of it yet, they said. So, they have effectively destroyed the whole middle class by exchanging them with technology, which can do the job cheaper and with fewer errors. This is just one example what the first invasion has to accomplish in order for phase two to be as smooth as possible. In all fairness, it's not just the Syrians who are working on this, they have lots of human minions helping them to accomplish their goals, wittingly and unwittingly, but the ideas are not human in origin. There's no use in putting blame on the Syrians, which would give them even more power, because we are gladly helping them and are therefore just as responsible. No one in their right mind, who is capable of looking into the future, and care about future generations, would substitute humans with machines and leave millions of people to their fate. Only a very irresponsible human would go along with that. So there are many of us who are just as guilty. 3. Channelers who have opened up their chakras start channeling. Who? We have discussed channeling before, both in level I and level 2, but we are going to take this subject quite a step further here in level 3, because some of these channeled entities play a major role in the Syrian agenda. So I am not implying that all channeled material is bad, or the entities evil. Much depends on the energies and vibration of the channeler, it's actually crucial. You receive information in direct relation to what you are prepared to receive, no more, no less. Also, the quality of the information from a specific channeler from a specific source may fluctuate in accordance with the channeler's mood or vibration at a certain occasion. So, even if we feel that a channeled source may be trustworthy one day, the next the quality of the information may not be so great. Therefore, we need to use discernment even with a source we normally trust. This is not because the source is intentionally willing to give you disinformation or bend the truth, it's because when the channeler is not with it and tuned in, other entities who correspond with those vibrations may come in and interfere, pretending to be the original source. When we feel that the source is giving us correct information, we say that the channel is clear. The opposite, when a channeled source is taken over by negative entities, is called not clear in the world of channeling. Many make the mistake of abandoning a channeler when they notice dis or misinformation embedded in the messages, when in fact the channeler may just have had a bad day. But it's also the channeler's job to be critical towards the messages he/she receives, or they will lose their credibility, and eventually their audience. I have spent a lot of time listening to channelers lately, and read channeled material from different sources, both those who are considered trustworthy and those who are not. Then I have compared what I got to see differences and similarities between the sources in order to find some kind of pattern. For example, what do these channeled sources really want? Why are they here? Are they as benevolent and helpful as they say they are, or are they just faking it? The ones I have listened to are not hoaxes, by the way. All of them are genuine channels and not something the channeler is making up. Although there are such fake mediums as well out there, they have a tendency not to be long-lived these days when people are spoiled with the genuine stuff. It's easy to distinguish between a human fabrication and a true channel, because the information we receive from a true source is way beyond the scope of knowledge of any human being, normally, and the questions are answered instantly, without any lags, which would be difficult, if not impossible, to fabricate by a human. However, there are also channels that are not originating in the metaphysical universe, but are transmitted via satellites by intelligence agencies, in order to mislead people. Those, I believe, are also relatively easy to distinguish from the real stuff, because the quality is not as high. Still, it's harder to distinguish between the military/intelligence sources and the real material than it is between a human who is faking it and a real source. But the messages transmitted from the military-industrial complex, Mike, is usually of such that sooner or later one will see through it, especially if we are used to listening to channeled material in general. Many sources come in all of a sudden in a person's life, sometimes as thoughts that the person feels is not their own. Then they can start communicating with that source back and forth, and a channeled communication can take place. It's important already in the early stage for the person to set limits and boundaries, and for example letting the source know that the channeler is only allowing uplifting communication that is for the benefit of him/her and/or the whole planet. It's more common that whole collective of star beings are acting as sources in a common effort, than that the source is just one entity, from what I have noticed. The energies of such non-physicals can be pretty intense, so it's crucial that the channeler is in good mental and physical shape, or the intense energies will eventually break down the body, like it has done with so many channelers who have been too open. Carla Ruckert is only one example, during the period she channeled RA. Others, in pure excitement, take on more than one source. They may be channeling 5 to 10 different sources, and that can be very dangerous to the body, first of all, and secondly, The channel is so wide open that they let any entity in, and it's very easy to be deceived. So if you're going to channel, my advice is to feel out the source, say no to it if it doesn't meet the guidelines, and wait for the right source to come then. Then stick to one source. Normally, when we ask the source a question, they look in the memory bank of the vehicles, the channeler, which often go back thousands and thousands of years due to the genetic memories from previous life, and they look in the Akashic records for an answer, in case they don't know it already. Basher, one of these sources, explains it pretty well when he says that the Akashic records are not, like many think, some sort of library in the sky where you have to go to find the answer. The records are all around us in the ether, it's there to immediately pick up and use. Then apparently, according to some sources, something I was not aware of, such as Hirony, who is a Grey whom Lissa Royale channels, these entities are using computer systems to gather their thoughts so that they become transmittable. Hirony says, emotions on my end are not necessary to channel, though I am working with physical facilitators on my end. Basher and Sasha and the three of us are linked into a computer device, my emphasis, that will synthesize our thoughts. They provide a balance for my thoughts so that the biological vehicle can receive them. Thus they are translated. Basher is of a Grey species as well, while Sasha is supposedly a Pleiadian. In the above case, the computer was apparently used in order to combine the thoughts of these three very different species. Is that really necessary, and make sense of it to humans? But if this is true, it makes me wonder how often channeled sources, called only sources from here on, use computers when answering questions that humans. Also, I said earlier in this paper that it is fairly easy to recognize sources that come from the military-industrial complex, MIC, but if the MIC is using extremely advanced computer systems, built or given to them during TTPs, and connected to special satellites using ET technology, how easy isn't it to copycat even advanced real sources def? I haven't had any trouble spotting MIC sources when I have plowed through these kinds of material, but who knows, maybe there is more sophisticated programs that can fool any of us and the lower quality MIC transmitters are only there to make us believe that this is the best they can do. If this is the case, we can only go on intuition and connect the dots to our best abilities.